Right. We're being immortalized, everyone. Yeah. Right. So, thank you, everyone, for joining. So, my name is Eleanor, for those of you who don't know, and I'm going to be giving a brief guide to tortoise care in the UK. We'll start with the welcome, which I've just done. I'm going to cover species, common questions, enclosures, diet, and then just touching on winter care, and then we'll have an open mic for questions and answers at the end, because there's not too many of us, we can do that instead of doing it with the written message. So there's some logos at the bottom just to explain. Tortoise Club is the local group that helps with welfare education, and the other logos are sort of more the national work and private work that I do. So why do we have tortoises in the UK? It all started with the import of wild tortoises back probably turn of the century when it really started, and it really took off post-war. So for 30 or 40 years, we were getting tortoises collected from the wild. In 1984, we realized that it was a little bit cruel and not sustainable. So there was an actual full ban on that, but there's still a lot of those animals still knocking around. The only problem with a lot of these early animals is, although they're surviving, they're not thriving in captivity. So some are overweight and underweight, they've got low body temperature, so the body isn't functioning properly, low immunity, they're lethargic, poor appetite, and they haven't had extra calcium in UV. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about this as we go along. So, keeping in the UK, at the moment we're looking at about 250,000 reptiles and amphibians bred in the UK alone each year, and this is increasing annually. A survey by Reptor has worked out there's about 1.2 million households, and over 7 million pet reptiles are kept in those households. So it's widely accepted that there are now more reptiles than dogs in the UK. So we really like our reptiles, and a large proportion of those are tortoises. So this is a big reason why a lot of these organisations have set up, including ours, Norfolk Tortoise Club. We have historically done open events where people can get to know fellow tortoise keepers. We have a shop and we do a talk, but obviously in the current climate it's quite difficult. So we're having a go at trying to do some online ones, and bear with us because we're still learning how to do it all. So just to give you an overview of the tortoise scene in the UK, these are some of the more common species that are kept in captivity over here. On the left, you've got what we would call the Mediterranean species. And on the right, we've got desert species and jungles. So redfoots and elongs would be considered the elongs. Hermans, two species. These are super common in the pet trade and leaf eaters, and they come from Southern Europe. We've got North African spur thighs. These are ones that would have come over before the ban, in 1984. They were heavily collected and there's still a lot knocking around, but they're all quite elderly now. We've got Turkish ibras. So they're more dark-shelled spur thigh tortoises and they're quite robust. They were imported before the ban, but we do also have ones that are now bred in captivity and sold as hatchlings as well. We've got Algerian whitey eyes. So these are extremely large North African species. You don't get these in the pet trade anymore. And these are ones that would have come in before the ban, and amazing animals. And the UK are so fortunate to have a lot of these beautiful animals still come surfacing and coming in free homing, and we get these coming. If everyone can make sure that they've got their sound on mute, that would be appreciated. Thank you. So horse fields, we've got Russian horse fields. These are quite new on the scene. We didn't get these before 1984, but they're now collected from the wild and bred in captivity. They're not protected by CITES law because they're from Russia. And they do make lovely pets, but they're not necessarily a beginner's pet because they're quite good at being grumpy, digging, as that lower picture says, just there, all muddy. And they can hide quite a lot as well. We've got leopard tortoises. They are non-hibernating species, beautiful markings. They can be quite expensive to keep because they actually need to have an enclosure with heated accommodation because of where they're from. And then solcatas, similarly, again, they need to be kept warm and they need a lot of space because they can get extremely large. This is the sort of thing you need to think about if you're going to go for a desert species. They need a lot of an area to walk around, lots of grass to graze on because they're a grass grazing species. And then you need an insulated shed as well with UV heating and basking lamps. And here's a close up of what the basking lamps would look like inside. These tortoises come up every year. People buy them thinking, oh, they really like the idea of having a giant tortoise. The reality of looking after a very large animal is a bit like having a pony, basically. They're very strong, they do massive poos, they eat a lot, and they can be quite expensive to look after. But if you do have the space and time, we'd love to hear from you because we really struggle to find homes, with people that can care for a giant desert tortoise, especially if you have space just to have one male, because males can be quite grumpy and we often need to rehome those on their own. This is an example of outdoor view of a insulated tortoise house. This was actually for radiated tortoises, which are down here, basking lamps. And then you have these fantastic T5 lamps, which are great when you've got groups of animals or large animals, because they have a brilliant spread of UV for helping to make sure the tortoise is getting enough vitamin D3 to absorb calcium, which is really important to tortoises. The other one that comes up for rehoming is a jungle species called redfoots. They like to have a leaf litter or a bark floor. They need good humidity. They need to be sprayed regularly. And they do have some fruit and carrion in their diet. And they don't hibernate. So the more common, and I say the bulk of our work, is working with the Mediterranean species, the ones that do hibernate. But even those, we're talking about so many different varieties because they come from Turkey, France, Croatia, North Africa, Italy, Spain, and each is slightly different with different sizes, markings, and characteristics. So some of you who arrived early may have heard, we do try and have a conversation with people who are interested in rehoming to try and find out what they might be interested in before we start showing them pictures, because there's so many different tortoises. We try and match and give a choice of tortoises that would suit what that person has available in their garden. Here are just some general shots. So we're often looking for solo homes where you've got a male that will fight. So that's like our number one. And males are really good as just a pet in a lone garden. But then we also are looking for people who have quieter gardens, maybe with no children and other animals, which can be low stress for maybe an elderly animal or a special needs animal. And then if people, their interest is growing and they've got time, we do also get females come in, but they're a little bit more complex and not so good for beginners because it's got to be a bit more involved, as this bottom picture is showing. You do have to give provision for egg laying. There's a big risk in captivity with females getting egg binding. And I'm convinced that's why us as a centre don't see so many tortoises, females come in for rehoming as males, because I think females are more prone to perishing if they're not given opportunity to lay eggs if they need to, even if they don't have access to a male. Okay, so common questions that we get when people come to rehome is, can tortoises live together? Well, the answer is you have to monitor it and manage it. And in some cases, it's just not appropriate. And these pictures are examples of that. So on the right hand side is a female that has been bashed so heavily by a male that it's actually damaged the outer layer of her shell and actually caused some shell rot here. So she will always have some scarring with vitamin treatment and regular cleaning with an iodine soap solution. This will heal a little, but you'll always see the remains of the marking of the damage there. On the left here, we've got a male where he's been bitten by another male on his leg. And you see he's got a little bit of a sore tail tip where he's been trying to mate other tortoises as well. So tortoises can lose condition and become stressed and damaged from other tortoises. So this is one of the main reasons why we're always looking for people who would just like to have one or can manage a group and make sure that if there's a tortoise that starts presenting aggressive behaviour, it can be pulled out and separated, so damage and harm does not happen. So this is an example of the early years. Why can't we put tortoises together, mixed species? Well, we now know that different tortoises have different immune systems. So it's really important to not mix different species, because it can actually be a death sentence, particularly to the more elderly tortoises in the group. There's also different mating rituals, which can then result in some really nasty harm if you're not careful. Another question we get is, can my tortoise just roam in the whole garden? I've got dogs, cats, chickens, rabbits, guinea pigs. It's like, well, you could, but again, it's a risk of stress, and particularly with bunnies, they can eat faster than tortoises. So we do recommend that the tortoise has an area which is sort of like the tortoise zone, where it can't be have other animals near it that are going to cause it to get stressed or not be able to have access to food browse. And you know, under supervision, it could technically have access to the whole garden, but you do need somewhere safe where the tortoise can be put away and other animals can't get in and actually cause damage. So the kind of questions that we get is, I want tortoise to be in the whole garden all year round. Okay, that can be fine, but it's very rare that a garden just has one purpose, say just for a tortoise. Very often you've got children, family, other pets, and you do need to take those into consideration. So these are the kind of pictures that we'd get when someone wants to rehome a tortoise, which both have potential. What we say is we want a enclosure to be picked in a sunny spot in the garden where it's going to get the most sun throughout the day. And then the way this works is you could have an enclosed area, which would then keep the tortoise safe from from dogs, for example, that might need to share the garden as well. And then if the children are playing, then you know the tortoise is safe within an enclosure. Obviously, if the children are at school or the dog's not in the garden, you can have a little gate, and then the tortoise can then have access to the rest of the garden. But it's really useful if you actually, we do ask people to actually create something that's specifically for the tortoise and I'm going to show you some more pictures, which is going to explain this a little bit later. These are some more examples. Say, well, why can't we use mesh and put it in a cage? Tortoises don't understand that they can't get through wire, and they can really, really hurt themselves and get super stressed trying to get out through anything they can see through. So this wouldn't be appropriate. And such a large garden here, the end of the summer, the tortoise can dig down and completely vanish on you. You can see there's also other dogs here, and I think there's also children's equipment as well. So again, there would be very good grounds to choose a sunny spot and actually make a raised bed here, for example, in the sun, where the tortoise can actually have a zone where it can have natural behaviour. Other items that you need to consider if you're going to take on a tortoise is that there isn't a pond for it to fall in, they can't swim. Picket fencing, just make sure they can't get underneath and that they're not going to rattle backwards and forwards, damaging their shell. Glass, tortoises don't understand they can't go through glass. So that's another example there. Open gates, it's worth considering having springs on the gate or having a plank to step over so the tortoise can't be left open and the tortoise isn't going to escape. And then climbing, never underestimate the climbing abilities of a tortoise, as that picture is showing. Just at a glance, some tortoise enclosures here. So just going back. So outdoor areas of like a minimum, if possible, we ask for sort of 6 foot by 6 foot, bigger the better when possible, in a sunny spot. And ideally somewhere that can catch the sun, like that can be an old fish tank on its side or polycarbonate house. And well planted with edible plants so the tortoise can have a healthy diet. Here are some examples here. So perimeter, bottom left here is paving slabs on end. This can work very well. These are small fence panels which have been dug down a little so the tortoise can't climb underneath. So just giving some examples here. And if you can have an adjoining greenhouse, then even better. So for bad weather days. So you're creating a natural environment. Tortoises aren't domesticated pets. So anything that you can do to help encourage natural behavior is going to help the tortoise have a better life. And it can be really beautiful for you to enjoy as well out in the garden. So thinking about, and great for wildlife. So making a nature area where the tortoise lives is sort of something that you should be aspiring to. And they love different aggregates and surfaces because they are different temperatures throughout the day, so they can regulate the temperature. It also helps keep their nails short as well. So we've got, in this enclosure, you've got edible browse, and then they can go in and out of the greenhouse as they please. They've got a heat lamp to help them warm up in the mornings if it's a cool day, and lots of different textures and surfaces for stimulation. This is an example of indoor accommodation for younger tortoises. So things to consider, tortoises in the wild come from arid habitats that are low in nutrient, high in fiber, low in protein. And so they're strictly herbivores and feed predominantly on natural grown produce. So creating something like this is ideal. Indoor space for bad weather and for nesting with heat lamps, and a sort of a natural Mediterranean outside. And this is an example of wild habitat. And these are some pictures from the centre. So shelters for in the summer, for nighttime use for the males. But with females, we do prefer it if they can actually also have a greenhouse. Because the females are often larger, it really helps them warm up on cooler days. On the left here are our indoor enclosures for bad weather. These are actually fish tank tubs, goldfish tubs, which you can buy from us if you're interested in having one. They're ideal for if you've just got one small tortoise for bad weather. And here are some of the enclosures being maintained by some of our volunteers. You do have to make sure grass doesn't take over, and you've got a nice spattering of edible browse, but not so much that you've got a jungle on your hands. Here's another example of an indoor space. So we've got these fantastic T5 UV lights, which are great if you've got groups. You can buy these on Amazon for about £50. And that just helps make sure that it's like being outdoors in terms of getting a D3 output. Basking lamps to help the tortoise warm to the core. You mustn't use ceramic radiators or red lights. It has to be a basking light and not a spotlight, because it can actually burn the tortoise. These are some examples of freshly made enclosures. Here you can see concrete slabs on end. This is an old wardrobe on its side, lined with a thick gauge plastic as an indoor space for the tortoise. So everyone does it differently, and you can have a lot of fun getting creative. So again, freshly made, you've got a hot box there. These are gravel boards dug in an inch or so the tortoise can't get underneath. And this is what we'd look on the right. This is what it looks once it starts to get established. So we're not looking for something that looks like it's from the wild immediately. What we want to see is the basics in place, a secure outside perimeter, then a hot box. And if you go on Pinterest, you can look up tortoise setups. So many groups and galleries where you can get inspiration, but I've deliberately put lots of enclosure pictures in just to help inspire everyone and show just how much variety and how you can do it differently according to what you have available. This is actually a project that we did with the local school on the left here. We actually let them adopt a male horse field to live on his own. He's got a little hot box, and he also has a tortoise table that he's brought into in really bad weather. And this is his outdoor habitat. And they've got different plants that they're growing so they can pick them and feed him a natural, healthy diet. On the right here is one of our rehomers from last year. Tortoise can go indoors and has a heat lamp indoors, but it can also come out through choice and walk around and enjoy an outdoor enclosure. Some more examples again. So when the tortoise can't be supervised or children are playing, it's got its own habitat. But then when the garden is quiet, there's this really cute gate which can be opened and the tortoise can enjoy the rest of the garden. What's so lovely is this is sort of completely geared to the tortoise. It's a little Mediterranean area in a sunny spot, which is exactly what we're looking for. And then inside, you've got a basking lamp for bad weather, got a tube heater on the wall that just stops it dropping too low at night towards the end of the year. And just some examples again. So I think we've got an old cupboard on its back, so it doesn't have to cost a fortune, and then lined with plastic and then with soil. And then again, this is done in a greenhouse, but you could easily do this in the shed under the potting table. Some examples again at the centre. And you can see the soil under these lamps. These are nesting areas for females. Some examples again. Right, so going on to some other aspects to consider if you are thinking about adopting a tortoise. So we do ask that you put calcium on food for tortoises. This is because in the UK, we don't have so much naturally occurring in plant matter, whether that be grown, and especially if it's bought from a cultivated source. We also should not be buying lettuce and bought produce, because it's where they grow it for the supermarkets is actually where tortoises' habitat should be as well. So it's another reason to be growing stuff and collecting sustainably locally, because you're actually affecting tortoises in the wild if you're actually going to buy bought produce. Egg laying again, just some more examples. Access to water. Now, some people say, I never see my tortoise drink. That is absolutely fine, but it doesn't mean that you shouldn't offer them access to water dishes in a few places in their indoor and outdoor enclosure. The other thing you can do, which costs nothing, which helps the tortoise stay hydrated and detoxed, is to actually give them a tepid warm bath once a week to encourage them to go to the toilet and stay hydrated and have healthy liver and kidneys. Here are some examples of growing food at the centre. We actually find that we are moving more towards having sort of rockery type areas for sunbathing for tortoises, with a few plants, cascading plants for them to nibble on, but also having raised planters where we can actually forage, where the tortoise isn't going to strip it and eat it down to the nub. So here we've got nasturtium is a great one. We've got hibiscus here. We've got antirrhinums. There's just a few examples. We've got evening primrose, and I think in the back corner there we've got sedum, and then we've got grapevine coming out of the greenhouse there, which are all great ones. Lavateria flower is a great one. Just a quick slide to say, you know, we do want to avoid junk food, and the reason is it's the equivalent of McDonald's for tortoises. Anything that's like veg or fruit or processed is to be avoided, because it can eventually be lethal to a tortoise, particularly sort of high protein ones like peas and beans and cabbage. And any of the brassica families actually prohibits the absorption of calcium, and beans are also high in oxalates and can prohibit the absorption of calcium. So it's really bad for them, and it can also cause a buildup of urea, which can then cause bladder stones, which can be lethal. Fruit, again, sugars are very bad for tortoises. They're just not designed to process that level of sugar in their bodies. And iceberg lettuce may be fine for a drink, but it has absolutely zero nutrition in it. So if you do have to buy any lettuce for a short period, or you want to grow a little, then go for like a baby gem, a Romany, or a rocket. But then always try and put in natural weeds and dried flowers on top to try and balance out and add vitamins and fibre in. So if you're not giving enough calcium and the tortoise isn't getting quite the right diet, there is a risk that they're actually going to have movement issues, like these tortoises here, which have had to have a little help. They often lose the use of their back legs first, and it can be very hard to rectify afterwards. These are tortoises that have actually got deformed shells from being fed junk food, and very transparent, poorly looking skin. And this can be a sign of vitamin deficiency as well. So it is important to sneak the Nutribell calcium on when you can. So this is what a plate should be. So maybe snuck in a few of their favourites, so a little bit of Romany lettuce if the tortoise isn't used to eating weeds. We've got some plantain in there, and then we've also got a little bit of dried flour and a little bit of grass cobs to add dietary fibre, and then dusted on top with calcium and D3. And I like to use a little bit of calcium and a little bit of Nutribell daily, because it's better to get the tortoise to eat it accumulatively than just to put it on a few times a week and then the tortoise just not eat on those days. I see that more than tortoise. I've never seen a tortoise that's actually been overdosed. So I think there's more risk that you're not going to get enough into the tortoise. So this is what I recommend. Just a few more visuals of the kind of food that you should be trying to feed. Plantain is a great staple. Lavateria flower, any of the soft thistle family is really good. Dandelion is okay, but you just got to remember not to feed too much of it because it's a diuretic. There's lots of plants you can buy from the garden centre and get established as well. And more than ever, there's lots of resources online. eBay, you can buy this edible plants book. I can't recommend this book enough. If you don't have it, then put it on your wish list. It's a great one. It's a picture book, cover to cover picture book, with loads of edible plants in there that you can find in the UK. It's a must have for anyone that has a tortoise. So recap, know your species. It's very important because it can affect how you look after it. Food should be appropriate to the habitat. Keep it high fibre, low protein with lots of calcium. Avoid unnatural food types and lots of access to fluids, and create a natural environment as possible. Okay, so just an overview. The club can help with a selection of basics should you need them, but there's just so many places online where you can now get all of these different products. The UV combi lamp is great if you've just got one or two tortoises. Ceramic fitting clamp lamp is important if you're using a 100 watt lamp for safety. Edible plants. And then here we've got calcium, dried foodstuffs, books, and then different substrates as discussed for the outdoor enclosures. And then, all importantly, your Nutribell multivitamin. So, just another mention now, all three of this wonderful author's books have been translated into English now, and I am pleased to announce that all three are available on eBay as of next week. So if you're interested in where tortoises are from and how they live in the wild, this is a beautiful book, a good general book, if you're interested. And on the right, feeder plants is super interesting. These are ones where he's actually observed tortoises feeding in the wild and seen what, and some absolutely beautiful pictures in. So again, a lovely wish list selection of books. Another shout out. This is a bit of a shameless one from me. I also do a lot of global conservation work when it comes to tortoises, and the European Turtle Alliance has been asked to work with a New York ballet company, and they're doing a virtual event where they're raising money to do the first ever conservation ballet, and you'll get to meet some of the artists and also see some specially created performances. So if you think you might be willing to support, there will be a link sent out through the different mailing groups, but you may also want to make a note of it as well and keep that date free. So this is the last slide. That seemed to go quickly. Has anyone got any questions? Mute everyone.
Everything goes quiet.
You can type it. People can type if they want as well.
So I've made an inquiry into adopting a tortoise. So where do we go from actually doing the form? Do you now need to see our garden? Do I get advice from you what to put in the garden? Or what do I And no, I've got lots of ideas, but I didn't want to sort of do things if it wasn't correct, like how high should the enclosure be? I mean, I've learned sort of a few things now, like you've got to dig down, which I didn't know before, you know. So I don't really know where to go from here, really, because I've got like, a summer house, I've got a shed, I've got a nice enclosed garden, you know, I've got a pond that's already enclosed anyway, everything, but I've only got a very, well, I've got a 7-year-old cat, but I haven't got any children and everything, and everything around me is very quiet. And I've got lots of like plants and, you know, rocks and everything, sort of an all over sort of garden sort of thing.
It sounds like a really good start. It's great that you've filled out the application form. What we normally say is a stage two is we send you some general information so you can sit quietly and watch a few YouTubes and get a feel for what the whole, what whether it's for you.
Yeah.
We then ask you to just send a basic shot of where you think you might build a tortoise zone in the garden that gets the most sun throughout the day, and also a photo of where you're thinking the tortoise might go in bad weather. So once you get to that point, just send two or three pictures over or a little video, and then one of us will get in touch to say that looks really good. As soon as you've got your basic indoor and outdoor perimeters in place, and you know you've pulled up the grass and you've got some aggregate in and you've got a shelter, we can talk about getting you matched with based on your background. So did you say have you got it's quite a quiet garden, have you got older children?
I haven't got any children of my own. I mean, there's a grandchild, but he's still only 8 months at the moment, so he's still quite young.
Okay.
But yeah, I mean, everything around me is very quiet. I mean, I've got elderly neighbors besides, so it's not like children screaming all the time, and I've got a 7-year-old cat that, you know, is, you know, it's not sort of a hyper cat or anything, like a kitten or anything. So it's quite a calming sort of environment. There's only the two of us, you know, it sounds quite a nice thing for a tortoise. And actually doing this, I didn't realize how many people at my own work actually have tortoises.
Yeah.
So it's actually, I've actually worked with people that have got them. So it's a really good, you know, I've learned quite a lot from them.
Yeah, there's so much variety in how people look after their tortoises as well. And nothing is black and white. But we do try and help people get off on the right foot so the tortoise is going to thrive in your care.
Yeah. Okay, I'll do that then. I'll get some ideas of where I'm going to put them in the garden. Then I'll know exactly that you'll say this is probably a good place to start building one. Or I've also got some things from like work, like enclosures from pallets and things. So I can show you sort of an ideas and coal frames I've got and things like that, just to give me some idea on that. No, that'd be brilliant.
Sounds really good. Have you got any other questions? Because this is sort of like a first attempt at trying to do a slideshow to kind of help those who are interested in rehoming. So I think I think the main thing is just trying to visualise what you've got to do next, isn't it? Okay. There's a lot to take on. But the main thing is that, like we've said, with the enclosure and send some pictures, and then once we know sort of what you can provide, we can go, well, these are your different options. Okay. And then once you've got the basics in place, we can look about actually booking you in to actually come and collect the tortoise.
That's brilliant. So shall I sort of make some pictures as well? I've sort of the coal frames that I've got, some things that I've got ideas of what actually using to say if you think that's practical or not.
Yeah.
And things like that would be brilliant. The other thing that I didn't see would come up, if say a tortoise gets ill, because someone at work has said the same thing, her tortoise not very well, but there isn't really any vets in Norwich or Norfolk. I think she found there's two vets the whole of Norfolk or Suffolk that actually will take in a tortoise if it's ill or anything. Is that something that you do as well?
It depends on what's wrong with the tortoise. Like we always say, sort of initial concerns, always feel free to message us and we can often save you a trip to the vet. Obviously, if you get a emergency, then, you know, if the tortoise actually has an accident, then obviously you need to go to the vet.
Okay.
But very often it's a husbandry related issue that we can normally work with you, so you don't actually need to go to the vet.
Oh, that's fine. I'll let her know that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, she's got actually three and she's had them for many, many years. I mean, I didn't even know, like, my dad had one when he was a boy, because you used to be able to buy them like from the market when they were little boys, you know.
Yeah.
They used to bring them home and have them. I mean, he had one for about 50 years, he said. And it just used to just run around the garden, and they used to see it every so often. It just used to do its own little thing.
Yeah, and we now, like, a lot of those old tortoises survived, and they did. And I think it was luck of the draw. So if the garden was south facing, sheltered, maybe had a brick wall around it, and the tortoise hibernated under a dry wisteria, then it you know, it's still here now. But other times,
oh dear.
Someone's phone going. Yeah. It's totally a lot of them did perish, so they fell in the pond, or they hibernated and never came up, or they escaped, or the dog ate it. So there are different.
I was going to ask you about the hibernating thing, because my dad said he used to just put his like in a box at the bottom of an airing cupboard, and they used to have to make sure the straw was dry and everything. Is that still the case? I mean, I used to have a neighbour that used to just bring them indoors and keep them in like like a conservatory or anything, and just used to just check on them ever so often just to make sure they're okay. Is that still the case, or do you have to keep them at a certain temperature?
It's good to keep a tortoise as a steady temperature as possible, so around 5 degrees. So with a wind of maybe like 3 to 8 degrees, any higher than 8 and the tortoise might start to stir and burn body fat. Any lower and you're getting a bit close to the tortoise actually freezing and actually causing damage to its eyes or mouth or nose or tail, which are the softest part of the tortoise that tend to get damaged first.
So it's best not to keep them too warm, but just keep that sort of in that mid.
Yeah, like fridge temperature, salad drawer temperature is 5 degrees.
God, it's quite amazing. So even if you could keep them in the shed would be absolutely fine.
It can be. If you're lucky enough to have a north-facing brick shed, then that can stay a beautifully steady temperature. It's like a traditional fridge. But if you have a south-facing wooden shed, there's a risk that it's going to spike in temperatures and be quite dangerous.
Get too cold. Okay.
And the same goes for if you've got a loft. So with modern insulation, they can actually be very perilous. They can get very hot and very cold very quickly. Mm. So we do normally say most lofts these days, it's a no-go when it comes to actually hibernating a tortoise.
Okay, well, that's quite interesting. I just wanted to see what sort of temperature you sort of need to keep them at, sort of thing.
So that's when they're hibernating you.
I remember my partner's uncle's got one, and we go around there every so often. It just lives in the garden. As you get there, it just comes out to say hello, and then it just sort of disappears. And he said it's just done it like that for tens of years. It's quite a big tortoise now, but it's I just find them amazing when they just walk around. I just think they're wonderful animals.
Yeah, I mean, in old age, the tortoises, often these ones are great, but they would benefit from occasionally sneaking in a little bit of multivitamin. Mm. Sort of any elderly animal could benefit from a little bit of helping hand in its old age, making sure it doesn't hibernate maybe for quite so long. If it's a really long winter, trying to keep an eye on where she might be hibernating, making sure she's got extra protection on top of her so predators don't get to her, making sure she doesn't get flooded. If she's sleeping too long, thinking about actually trying to wake her up and moving her somewhere, gently warming her up somewhere, giving her a bath, giving her a glucose bath straight out of hibernation, just to make sure that she's not going to be too debilitated post hibernation. She's going to pull through for another year.
Yeah. No, it's been really interesting, actually, this tortoise. I've actually learned a lot tonight, because you sort of look a lot online and everything, and you can see what people build and all different things, but it's actually been sort of an eye-opener. So I will do that. I'll get some pictures of the garden, some ideas, and before I sort of go down, you know, where I need to put the light and everything else, just sort of get the bare basics together. And
I mean, there's so much. It's such a huge subject, it's really hard to kind of give a taste for kind of what's involved in getting started. But the main thing is that you have a willingness to make some adaptions to make a nice Mediterranean feature area in your garden that would be for a tortoise. If you're prepared to do that and work with us, it's very rarely do we not help someone find a tortoise. Someone's prepared to put the time in to make these small tweaks, and they're happy to put them under a lamp in bad weather, feed them a healthy diet, weeds and flowers, not hibernate them for too long, stay in touch for support, then we want to know you and we want to help you find your perfect pet. So we're not going to say you must have this tortoise. We'll always have like 3 or 4 tortoises that will go, well, we think this one, but there are also these ones. So you always have a choice, but it can be, there's so many different varieties that will say, well, okay, you've got young children, so we don't say no, we won't rehome to young families, for example, but what we would do is probably give a more robust breed that's a little bit less prone to stressing. So like a younger male Turkish Iber, for example, which are known for being quite robust. and saying, okay, this is going to be your pet tortoise. But equally, if you want a pet that you want to cuddle and stroke, you shouldn't really have a tortoise. They're more for watching and enjoying and, you know, helping you relax. They're not a domesticated pet. I mean, get a cat if you want something to cuddle and stroke.
No, I've got a cat that's a pain in the bum.
Yeah.
Drives me mad all day long. But do you, because some people say online that you do need to watch the cats for a few weeks with them just to make sure they do sort of.
Yeah, if you've got a really small tortoise, you do need to have a cage cover on top.
Right, okay.
Because there's a risk the cat can pick it up and chew it. With dogs, smaller tortoises are a huge risk. At being chewed just in a few moments, and even older tortoises you have to be really careful that their limbs don't get chewed. Foxes are a problem, rats can be a problem, so these are things that you need to kind of be keeping an eye on to make sure that there isn't any risk in your garden for that.
That's good. Yeah, because she's only a very tiny cat, so it's sort of thing I was just saying. And it's also quite interesting what you said about the wire as well.
Yeah.
So they can't see through, so that's quite a good point as well.
Yeah,
so
yeah, it's been really good. Cat and dog poo, like, unfortunately in the wild, tortoises will try and eat other animals' poo because that might be the most nutritious thing that they're going to see in weeks. So they don't understand that cat and dog poo is not good for them. And the main reason for that is the cat or dog might have been wormed recently or been given another
form. Okay. That's
and that can be really toxic. So it's really important to clear those away and make sure that that's not going to be a risk.
Mm-hmm. That's a very good point, actually, keeping cat poop. Yeah.
Can anyone think if there's anything else I should mention related to owning a tortoise? I mean, they live a really long time, so important to have a folder like with all the information about the tortoise, so if something happens that someone else knows kind of what weight it should be and if it has any health issues. Microchipping the tortoise is really important. If you're rehoming a tortoise, then we do give we do try and microchip the tortoise when it's healthy enough before it goes out to a new home.
Mm-hmm. And taking a picture of back and front of it as well.
Yeah. Back and front is really good, so it forms for basic identification. It's really good. And screening for worms in the summer months is really good. It's important not to worm just before hibernation and equally not straight out of hibernation, because tortoises are a little bit more prone to be lethargic, sit around, and then you'd have the toxic wormer sat in their stomachs for longer than necessary, and that can actually cause damage the gut lining and can actually be life-threatening. So better to screen for worms if they have a very low worm count than don't do it. And not necessarily a low worm count is fine. You don't have to worm multiple times unless you had the most amazingly horrendous worm infestation, which is super rare. That normally only happens if the tortoise is actually getting the wrong diet as well. It's getting a more sort of high sugar fat diet and it's not having a really high fiber diet, because a healthy high fiber diet is naturally going to push the worms through and keep the worm count low.
How do you actually know if it's got worms or not? Is that something you sort of show when we come to look at a tortoise, sort of all the bare sort of things to look out for?
I think routinely it's good to check. If you only have one or two, you only have to worm check every sort of couple of years.
Because, right, okay.
They're less likely to, but if you have a group, you just have to routinely worm normally, because they sort of reinfect each other in groups. And also feeding natural food, they can pick up worms from snails and other wild animals that could have crawled across the food that it's eating, or even from the ground. So it's just something that is part of being a tortoise. They have worms in the wild, but the most important thing is that they don't get high levels of worms because it can actually compromise their immune system. So if you do need to do it in the summer, and then follow up with increased bathing. If you can, get an inexpensive tortoise reptile probiotic, like this one called AviPro. You can always ask us about this if you ever need to do this. And feed them lots and bath them lots to make sure that that wormer is getting through the system as quickly as possible, so it's not sitting in there for weeks.
No, that's good. I mean, with the new tortoise and that, can you sort of every 6 months or something, just send you a picture of the tortoise so you just know we're on the right track, that you know, if you think there's something wrong with the tortoise or we're not doing anything right, is that something that
we do really encourage it? You can tell a lot from a picture from an enclosure. We were doing health checks, but because of the virus situation, it is a bit tricky. But yes, if anyone wants to send us pictures or ask Q&A, then they're very welcome.
Oh, that's good. That's brilliant.
Anyone got any other questions?
Hi, can I just ask a question? We go camping a lot, and we're currently seeing a lot of campers who take their tortoises with them. What is your view on that?
I think that you have to be really careful with biosecurity, and tortoises are very good at running away. We have a huge problem in the UK. We love our tortoises, but our lifestyles have changed a lot. We're travelling a lot more. People are going camping. And finding someone to look after your tortoise and check in on it in your own garden can be really tricky. So it's not advised because tortoises get stressed being bumped around in cars. If you had a baby tortoise and it was in a plastic tray environment with a cage on top and someone was really caring for it, then sometimes needs must. But it is best avoided if you can find someone, a neighbour, to make sure the tortoise is the right way up in its normal enclosure, then that should always be the preference.
Okay. That answers that question. That's fine. Mm. The other thing, is it a good idea to have a tortoise this time of the year just before hibernation, or are we better to persuade you to let us have one in the springtime?
I would say that the tortoises should still be staying active until sort of well into sort of the late Septembers, and then you should be encouraging it to be pottering around a greenhouse or a utility room with a basking lamp in bad weather, and then going out when it can, when you get occasional bright days in October and then through till November, because we're a lot milder and it's easier to find food this side of December. Then the time to try and hibernate a tortoise would be in the worst months, which would be December, January, February, and then try and not let it hibernate more than 3 months, and then start to bring it into a warmer room and then do the same process in reverse. So having it sort of lower gear, still pottering around, but enough to eat wee and poo somewhere like away from the extreme elements. And then as soon as you start getting breaks in the weather, warm the tortoise up for a few hours and then let it go out for the middle of the day, and then slowly extend that so the until you get to a point where it's not really dropping below 10 degrees at night. The tortoise has a shelter outside and it can stay out for most of the time for the summer months. The only exception would be is if you have a larger female tortoise, because they struggle to raise up in temperature. We do encourage people wherever possible to have a greenhouse with a female, particularly larger females, because they really do struggle and they need to get decent temperatures up in order to ovulate and actually lay eggs if they need to. And like I said before, even if you don't have access to a male, there is potential that a female may still need to lay eggs just from being handled.
Okay. And one more question, is a tortoise sort of clever enough to know if the weather's bad, it will get undercover?
Unfortunately, tortoises can have very good natural instincts, but sometimes tortoises have just been kept really warm inside, and you put them in and they just feel like they've landed on Mars and they don't know how to be a tortoise. So in that case, it's a bit like hardening off a plant. You just sort of need to sort of break them in gently and get them used to knowing where their house is and where they need to go and what they need to eat and how they need to behave, and slowly getting used to functioning at lower temperatures, helping them out, giving them putting them under the lamp, giving them a warm bath in the morning to warm them up. And just slowly you'll find they'll get used to functioning a little bit more easily in those temperatures. Does that answer that question?
It does, actually. Yeah. The other thing is, I'm recently retired, so I obviously don't want a baby tortoise because they last sort of, well, up to 100 years, I believe, and above. So would you then try and pair me with an older tortoise?
We're not ageists, so we will always help anyone who is fit and able to look after a tortoise. We will always give family and friends first refusal if circumstances change in the future, and it can be returned to us also, and we can repeat the process again in the future. We would probably match you with a tortoise that wanted a bit of a quieter life as well in retirement, because you're going to have a bit more time to kind of meet its needs. So someone who wants an older tortoise, you sound perfect. So anyone can go out and get a baby tortoise from a breeder or from a shop, but trying to persuade people to set up to actually help an older tortoise thrive in captivity is something quite special, because a lot of these animals have been residents in the UK for 40 plus years. So you're also taking on a bit of history as well, which I think is quite special.
And with an older tortoise then, would it be good to sort of replicate the living conditions that they have had previously?
Take it into consideration. So sometimes if a tortoise has been on a bad diet, we'll give you like a feeding plan. So we'll say, okay, this tortoise has been used to eating a bit of lettuce, but what we always recommend doing is sort of weaning them off. So you start, but then we say just start trying to keep offering, sort of over sort of a year or a couple of years, you just sort of gently keep building up the ratio of weeds to make sure that it's getting a really high fiber diet, healthier diet. And a lot of people, they bring back the tortoise and you can see the transformation of all the hard work they've done. You know, they're slothing better, their skin is better, they're standing taller, their eyes are brighter, they're a more active animal because suddenly they're getting a little bit of help. They're getting a basking lamp for bad weather days to help sort of bring up that core temperature. They're getting multivitamins to help make sure that they're getting all the trace elements and vitamins that they need that they're not getting from not being in the wild. And just going back to your question about knowing about the weather, tortoises do have a natural instinct to sleep. And because Britain has longer winters, that's when tortoises get into trouble because they go, oh, it's cold, I'm going to go to sleep. Problem is in Britain is we can have winters that are really like 6 months, year in, year out. And although a tortoise can survive 6 months, it's not really designed to do that for six decades in a row. Like maybe the odd really bad winter, but not year in, year out. And they can come out so debilitated, and particularly with an aging population of tortoises in the UK, everything that we can do to make sure that these elderly tortoises aren't perishing just through us, you know, putting them through sort of a really aggressive hibernation, it's kind of the least we can do, really. We've had them here this long.
And are we able to come to your premises and see how you look after them and what sort of living conditions they've got?
If we do, if you're thinking about rehoming and you're quite close, then we do welcome people to come and have a walk around and just to help them visualise what's involved in rehoming. We do ask for a small donation of £10 just towards our time. But then if you do adopt, then we knock that off the rehoming fee.
And adoption fees, I mean, how much do you charge?
So we just look to recoup our costs, and you get a goodie bag with multivitamin, calcium, foodstuffs, care sheets, and we ask you have to own a basking lamp, so you can buy that from us or you can buy it from elsewhere. So the adoption fee, Jackie, tell me if I'm wrong, I think it's 75 for a tortoise.
£75 includes the tortoise and your rehoming pack.
Yeah,
and that is a donation. So yeah,
and it comes with microchipped and also health checked from us as well.
That's brilliant. That's brilliant. Yeah,
sounds great. Smashing. Thanks for the information. Really appreciate the talk as well. And I'm so glad you dropped it back a week because I couldn't make last week.
No, I couldn't do last week.
Yeah. Okay. I'm glad it's been helpful.
Thank you.
We'll keep trying.
No, I was going to say is because I have got an allotment as well, so I'm quite pleased that I can actually grow a lot of the vegetables and stuff actually for the tortoise. So it's quite good that I can, you know, do that away from the garden as well. So
yeah,
I've got plenty of weeds and stuff at the allotment.
yeah. So like raised planters, and there's also plants that you put in your own human food anyway, like salads and things.
Yeah.
But like the nasturtiums. You know, what we could eat in the kitchen as well. Vine leaves as well. Grapevines is great.
I've got a massive grapevine going in the greenhouse, so that'd be brilliant.
And there's great seed mixes that you can grow as well. And you can dry them if there's excess, and you've got rose petals, hibiscus, lavateria. and so on and so
can
forth.
Can they eat dahlia flowers and things like that? Or is some quite poisonous for tortoises? Is there anything you have to really not, you know, watch that you've got?
Jackie?
There's several things. Anything growing from a bulb,
right? We say
definite no. There is an absolutely fantastic app called the Tortoise Table app, because they've covered everything that a tortoise can and can't eat. Safe feeds, moderate feeds, no feeds. We actually don't, we haven't added to that, because there is an app that's absolutely perfect. You can basically check anything on that.
Oh, brilliant. That's good to know. Yeah.
Yeah. When people apply to Rehome, I can link up with people on WhatsApp for picture sending and stuff like that. That's absolutely fine. If I haven't got back to anybody, I do apologise, because it's been a bit mad, as you can imagine. We've had so many tortoises in. But if I haven't replied to you, then please send another email and I will. I normally send people out with information to help them to pick the correct foods. I mean, Eleanor has actually done some videos as well, which you should have all had sent to you.
I've had a good look at that, yeah.
And that does run through a lot of the feeds and the safe feeds what you can. But the best one is the Tortoise Table app. Bridie has now added a link to it in the chat if anybody's interested in seeing it. So if you bring up your chat on here, Bridie's added the link to that as well.
Oh, brilliant. I mean, I'm like the gentleman as well. I mean, I only go to work once a week. So if you do have older tortoises that need a bit of help, I'm only going to work once a week. So, you know, I'm more at home than I've ever been. So if that helps to do another old one, I'm quite happy to
that. You sounds ideal, both of you. We need to put you in a machine and multiply you.
Yeah, but is it Claire that
it is? It's Claire, yeah. So I can't get my camera to work, unfortunately, on my laptop.
No, that's absolutely fine. I've just looked at the emails and I've worked out who you are from your, I've sort of deciphered it and thought, right, that's Claire, I'll message her later. But yeah, like I said, quite happy to link up on WhatsApp or anything like that if you want to send photos rather than
I'll get that all done, yeah.
And then if you let me know, then I can give you my number, because that's on my phone, not on the club phone. So, all right.
You know, that's actually been, because I've got loads of access to wood and everything else. So I'm quite keen to build and everything else. So it's just sort of getting started, really, now.
It's good fun once you get started.
Yeah. Honest. Building things. We like building and having a go.
Yeah. It's good.
Excellent. Well, thank you, everyone, for joining us. Feel free to send us questions via our email and message if you think of anything later. But otherwise, have a really lovely evening, and we'll if you've got any feedback or requests for other talks, then please let us know. Let us know how you think that, how helpful this event's been, and we'll all see you soon.
That's been brilliant.
Yeah. Thank you
very
much. Thank you.
Okay, bye.
Yeah, and I'll come back to you shortly. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks.
Which kind of way get your boots to question, is it? Going on so long.
Bye. Thank you, Eleanor.
You're welcome.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Hello.
Hello. Hi. Thank Did you want to ask a question? Someone's saying hello.
Just asking a question, actually. I'm John Lill from Grimsby.
Hi.
I've already got three tortoises at the moment. I was hoping to adopt another old one.
Okay.
But will they go together? I've got the sort of got at the moment two spare side ones, mm-hmm. and a Moroccan, and they get on beautifully together.
Okay.
I've got no problem at all.
Okay. Do you know if they're girls or boys?
All males.
Okay.
I've had about 30 years now, all three of them.
That's
lovely. Well, two of them, anyway, but the third one I got to a rescue about 5 years ago.
Yeah. Do you know what type that is?
The two spare side ones. That's one that was the rescue one as well. The small one, called a mocking one.
Yeah. What we normally say is if you've got males, if you've managed to have two or three and they're getting on really well, then you've done so well. Like it's quite unusual to get males that aren't sort of bumping each other round too much. So
well, the little one does a bit, but he soon gives up.
Yeah. I think that if you've got a little trio that are getting on, I think it really wouldn't be advisable to try and drop another tortoise in there.
Yeah.
The other thing with North African spur thighs is they're very prone to picking up viruses. So there's a mycoplasma and a herpes virus, which can really just wipe them out. You could risk losing those as well. So I would say that it's better to kind of pamper that your sort of elderly trio that you've got.
Oh, we do that, don't
you? Stay in touch and listen to our talks and stuff. And if you feel like you've got more space and you wanted to do something separate, then we're happy to work with you. But it sounds like if you've got some lovely little oldies, I think it's better just to sort of cherish them.
Well, I think two are about 70 or 80 years old.
Yeah, I think
you could buy one, and the other one not about 70.
Yeah, I think you could probably tip the balance if you.
And we're doing everything for them, sort of thing.
Yeah.
We've done the lot for them.
Oh, that's lovely. That's lovely. Yeah. I hope you found the talk interesting with the pictures and things.
Yeah.
Good. And did you hear about us through our email list?
The emails,
Oh, wonderful.
I've joined you as well.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Stay in touch. Thanks for asking the question.
Thanks for answering.
Send us some pictures. We're always happy to, always lovely to see tortoises that people own. So, email us some pictures.
these are lovely little boys. They are straight.
Yeah.
I think the rescue one, I think it's got a little bit of brain damage actually, because it's a bit, and most of the times I have to sit hand feed it.
Yeah,
because it tries to go for it, and it opens its mouth and it goes for, it brings its head back from side to side a little bit.
Well, I said in the talk, some multivitamins, if you can hide it in the equivalent of a vitamin tablet, so like some slices of cucumber, and then hide some Nutribal is absolutely fantastic. You can pick it up really inexpensively. They don't like it, but if you hide it in something watery and feed it to them like a vitamin, that can make a huge difference. If you've got an oldie or any tortoise, if you can get that into them, that can make a huge difference in their general health and help keep expensive vet bills away.
Because the way they don't really drink that much, so what I do is I soak the food well in water. It's laying in water actually.
Yeah.
And that's the only way I can get them to get water.
Yeah.
And bathing them and all that.
Yeah. All right. Well, good luck. Thanks for sharing.
Thanks for the help. Anyway,
have a lovely evening. Take care.
Thank you. All the best to you.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.